Plants require nutrients which are essential for successful growth and optimum yields. Without their presence, the consequences can range from stunted growth, leaf discoloration, and loss of fruiting bodies, all of which lead to reduced crop yields. Macronutrients are required in larger amounts, whereas micronutrients are only required in very small amounts, parts per million. Plants require a balance of all the essential nutrients for normal growth. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and this video provides details about the micronutrients or trace elements plants need, as well as the beneficial elements. Trace elements or micronutrients play many roles in plants, many difficult to describe without knowing plant chemistry. Most micronutrients are classified by chemists as metals. These metallic trace elements, with the exception of molybdenum, will be treated in this section. Metallic trace elements interact with special molecules called enzymes that control important biological reactions. Enzymes are keys that activate biological reactions in living systems. They are not consumed in the process, but are reused repeatedly. Therefore, very little of the enzyme is needed, hence little of the associated trace element is required. Without this tiny amount, however, important processes suffer. On the other hand, an excess of a trace element can be toxic to plants. Metallic trace elements have certain similarities. They are taken up by plants as simple cations, like the ferrous ion Fe+2. They also form complex metallic organic molecules called chelates, in which a metal ion is surrounded by a large organic molecule. Chlorophyll itself is an example of a chelated magnesium. In the soil, humic acid acts as chelating agents. Chelates are an important form of storage for metallic ions, and in this form, they are somewhat protected from being tied up by other chemical reactions, though in some situations, chelation itself may tie up a micronutrient. Artificial chelates are also used as micronutrient fertilizers. As cations, metallic trace elements also adsorb to colloid surfaces, so the cation exchange process both stores them and makes them available to plants. Iron, the trace element used in the greatest amount by plants, is part of many enzymes necessary in the formation of a number of chemicals, especially chlorophyll. Iron compounds also transfer electrons during many of the reactions involved in respiration and photosynthesis. The solubility of iron compounds relates directly to pH, declining about 100 times for each rise of one pH point. Acid-loving plants suffer iron shortages when pH rises above 5.0 or 6.0, while many plants become deficient at higher pH. Iron chlorosis is the usual symptom of iron hunger. It is easy to see as an intravenal chlorosis on new growing leaves. While leaf veins remain green, tissue between the veins become light green or yellow. In trees, branches begin to die back. Fruit and other horticultural crops commonly show these symptoms. Examples include azaleas, pin oaks, and blueberries. Various treatments are available to overcome a lack of iron. Soil pH can be lowered to free the iron. Soluble iron compounds such as iron sulfate may be mixed into the soil, sprayed on leaves, or even injected into the trunks of trees. Artificially prepared chelates may be used in the same way. And animal manures can be mixed into the soil. Manganese resembles iron in that weathering releases a cation that is tied up in non-acid soil. Manganese acts with iron in the formation of chlorophyll. Manganese speeds seed germination and crop maturity and helps plants take up several other nutrients. Manganese deficiencies are usually seen on calcareous soils or on soils that have been overlimed. Dwarfing is a common symptom of manganese deficiency, accompanied by intravenal chlorosis of middle to younger leaves. Sometimes flecks of dead tissue appear in the leaf. Iron and manganese can interact in soil or plants in ways that can induce deficiencies or toxicities of one or the other. For instance, if a tree has a manganese deficiency with symptoms resembling iron chlorosis, one might apply iron. The new iron will only reduce manganese uptake and aggravate the real problem, so soil testing should be done first. Deficient soil can be treated by mixing manganese sulfate into the soil. Lowering pH by applying sulfur may also be helpful. Leaves may be sprayed with a solution of manganese sulfate or chelate. The zinc cation is weathered out of soil minerals where it can be absorbed, form a chelate, or form slightly soluble zinc compounds. Several biological reactions use zinc, including chlorophyll and protein production. Zinc also controls the synthesis of a plant hormone, indole acetic acid, that stimulates plant growth. Low zinc levels are widespread in many crops, including beans, corn and rice, and pecan on alkaline soils. The symptoms of zinc deficiency in plants are quite varied, but include tight growth of small, closely spaced leaves, interveinal chlorosis, and dead spots on leaves. Zinc is most available in acid soil, least available on alkaline or recently lime soils. Soils that have lost topsoil by leveling, terracing, or erosion may also be poor in zinc. Low levels may also appear on very coarse soils because the parent materials lacked zinc and the soils tend to be low in organic matter. Like iron, a lack of zinc can be treated by fertilizing soil or spraying foliage with zinc compounds or chelates. Sewage sludge is an excellent source of zinc. Copper is held by cation exchange and combines chemically with organic matter. Some organic copper complexes are so stable that the copper is unavailable to plants. Copper is part of a number of important enzymes, especially for the formation of chlorophyll and lignin. Copper affects how well a plant resists disease and how well it controls moisture. Copper shortages also inhibit pollen formation, reducing fruit yields. Shortages are not common, but symptoms include poor fruiting, distorted new growth, stunting, and leaf bleaching. Shortages are most likely to be seen in either leach sands or peats and mucks. A few pounds per acre of copper sulfate mixed into the soil usually supply all the copper that is needed. Carrots grown on organic soils may need extra copper, but small grains and other vegetables sometimes suffer as well. Nickel is the most recently identified essential element, and one needed in the least amounts. It is required by plants and microorganisms for the proper metabolism of the simple nitrogen compound urea and perhaps other uses. While deficiencies are rare, a symptom of tiny leaves called mouse ear has been observed on river birch and some other trees. Nickel can be toxic to biological symptoms at relatively low levels. While plants acquire the metallic trace elements as cations, the following elements behave as anions. Molybdenum, while a metal, behaves as an anion as well. As anions, they do not participate in cation exchange. Storage is mostly in organic matter. Boron exists in the soil largely as boric acid, which is taken up by plants and gathers in organic matter near the soil surface. Fixation at high pH and leaching limit the amount of boron plants can use. While the functions of boron are still not well understood, a number of functions have been proposed, such as cell wall and membrane integrity and regulation of carbohydrates and proteins. Boron deficiencies are fairly widespread in alkaline soils that limit its availability in high rainfall areas where it leaches readily and under drought conditions that limit uptake. A shortage of boron often appears as death of terminal buds, followed by tight, bushy growth known as rosette growth. Thick, fleshy tissues such as cauliflower stems may crack, become hollow, and begin to rot, causing a black heart symptom. Boron toxicities are relatively common in arid and semi-arid regions, with soils of parent materials rich in boron, or where irrigation water contains boron. Boron tends to migrate to leaf margins, where it may cause marginal yellowing and cupping. Molybdenum, the nutrient with the smallest plant requirement except nickel, is necessary for proper nitrogen metabolism by plants and for nitrogen fixation by both symbiotic and free-living bacteria. It gathers in soil organic matter and, unlike other micronutrients, is most available at high soil pH. Shortages are most common on acid, leached, and low organic matter coarse soils, as well as acid peats. Plants in the mustard family are especially sensitive. Whiptail of cauliflower, for instance, results from a lack of molybdenum. An ounce of soluble molybdenum material, often mixed with phosphate fertilizer, will usually treat an acre of deficient soil. Frequently, liming releases enough of this trace element to cure shortages. Greenhouse poinsettia growers find molybdenum fertilization necessary to avoid such symptoms as yellowing leaf margins and leaf curling. Chlorine is a common substance on the planet, found everywhere to some degree. Its compounds are highly water-soluble and easily taken up and translocated by plants, which need very little of it. Not surprisingly, chlorine deficiencies are very rare, most commonly found in palms, which have a higher requirement than most plants. Chlorine is mainly found as a simple chloride anion in both soil and plants. Its biological role is not well understood, but it seems to act as a solute along with potassium in certain plant roles such as guard cell functioning. As a consequence, it is needed for controlling the opening and closing of leaf stomata. It also plays a role in photosynthesis. Most plants actually contain more chlorine than they really need, and toxicity is a bigger issue than deficiency. In salted soils of arid regions and in potted plants, chlorine toxicity can occur in such sensitive species as most fruit trees, bean, and cotton. A number of other elements contribute to nutrition of certain plants, although they may not be currently considered universal essential elements. Cobalt is considered to be an essential element by some, is needed for nitrogen fixation. In a sense, it is an essential element for nitrogen-fixing bacteria. This makes cobalt an important element for legumes and other nitrogen-fixing plants. Silicon is needed by some grasses and horsetail, especially wetland grass species. Adequate silicon is needed for best yields in rice and sugarcane. Research also shows that high silicon content strengthens cell walls and reduces disease infections and insect attack. Sodium appears to be required for many plants native to sodium-rich soils. Plants that need sodium also include species that have special types of photosynthesis adapted to hot, sunny climates, C4 and CAM photosynthesis. These include cacti, succulents, and many warm-season grasses such as corn and sugarcane. In conclusion, many micronutrients play an essential role in cells, especially in chlorophyll formation. Many trace elements like copper react with organic matter in the soil to form chelates. A lack of any one nutrient causes poor or abnormal growth, and measures can be taken to correct the deficiency.